Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning, those who are here and those who are watching online. It is wonderful to have you with us this morning. I will start out with a few announcements, as we typically do. Coming up in the life of the church this week, we have choir on Wednesday night, 7:15, if you're available. I know they're always accepting new applications, so if you're interested, please just show up Wednesday night or talk to Dennis, and he will gladly plug you in. You may have noticed there are a couple of birthday cards on the back table. If you have not taken the time to sign those for our friends at the Chapel House, Kevin, whose birthday is on October 16th, and also Hank, whose birthday is November 25th. So if you would take time to please sign those cards, the gifts have been purchased for their birthdays, and those will be delivered. And a reminder that also next Sunday, we will celebrate Laity Sunday. We have a special guest speaker who's going to be here to lead. Leanne is going to lead next Sunday. So please invite a friend, and we will worship together next week. Are there any other announcements that I may have overlooked? No. Well, seeing none, will you please stand with me as we sing hymn number 328, Surely the Presence of the Lord is in this place. Welcome to God's house, a place of faith.
From our homes, it comes to the King of God.
Here you will find nourishment and hope.
Maybe around lessons of courage and peace.
Here you will find rest from your struggles.
Lord, prepare our hearts to receive your words, that we may leave this holy house of faith and return to our homes in courage.
Amen. Will you please pray with me? Liberating God, you give us commandments not as a burden to bear, but as an invitation to live the life you have for us. Grant us open hearts, ready to accept your invitation, that we might become a people who bear the fruit of the freedom and new life that you give us. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 77, How Great Thou Art. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Psalms, Psalm 19, verses 1 through 14. Psalm 19, verses 1 through 14. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens he has pitched a tent for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming forth from his pavilion, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is hidden from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are sure and altogether righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the comb. By them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. Who can discern his errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Then I will be blameless, innocent of great transgression. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen.
Good morning. Good to see you, all of you. So God gave us, one of the beautiful Sunday. So now we are in the season of autumn. It is great to see the beautiful scenery day by day. This time is the sharing time. Do you have any joys and concerns and prayers? Yes.
Praise my mom is getting better, healing well. Continued prayers for her also as she recovers from knee surgery. Yes. Her name is Sharon.
Sharon.
Yeah. And also prayers for Lachlan, who's in New York City right now on a band trip with the school. Just prayers for him as he navigates the big city and hopefully has a good time there.
Who?
This is my son, Lachlan.
Oh, Lachlan, yes. Yes. Okay, yes. I heard that the last week, Debbie's daughter got surgery, so now she's in recovery. So we need to continue to pray for her. This week, my family, my wife and myself will visit New York to see our first daughter, Gina. So Monday through Wednesday will be in tour. So please keep in your prayers. Yeah. Okay, let us pray. Dear God, we stand in awe of your creation. We gaze at the autumn leaves with fresh air. Thank you, Lord, for having this wonderful and beautiful season. Dear God, also we give thanks for your goodness and for unfailing love, which are prevalent in nature in our journeys. Thank you, Lord, for your unfailing love in your Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came to us to be with us and to save us for his humbleness and obedience. Thank you, Lord, for accepting us as your beloved children. Thank you for calling us as your people so that we can live for you. This morning, dear Lord, now we give thanks for gathering together to worship you. So we ask your continued blessing upon our faith community so that we can serve you, we can worship you without fear, with a peace. Dear God, we ask your blessing upon each family and each church member. You bestow your goodness and unfailing love. Keep us in your goodness so that we can dwell in your grace day by day and through our journeys. Now when we are in the season of harvest, we ask your blessing, all farmers, and bless each of them. Also, we ask your blessing for each of us and keep us in health and peace. In our world, we hear some bad news, which shows divisiveness in our nation. We hear the war in the world. In this situation, dear Lord, now we lift up our prayer for our peace. Even though we cannot do many things in this situation, we lift up our concerns and our prayers for peace in Israel, Palestine, and in all the world. Dear God, you created us as your image, with goodness, thoughtfulness, and unfailing love. And bless each of our journey so that we can live in you, following the way of Jesus Christ. This time, dear Lord, now we continue to pray Matthew's mom, Sharon, who is in recovery from the knee surgery. So we ask your presence and healing grace day by day. Also, we lift up our prayer for Matthew's son, who is in tour in New York. Bless this time so that he can experience great things. Today, dear Lord, now we are here to share God's word. Open our hearts and our minds. Illumine with your word so that we can live as your people. This time, dear Lord, now we lift up our unspoken prayers so you know what we need. So today we bring our prayers to you for ourselves, family, and our church, and our foundation. This time, let us have a moment time for silent prayer. Let us pray with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today, we have no children. Today's scripture reading, Philippians chapter 3, 1 through 14. So if we are able to, could you stand up? Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you. Watch out for those dogs, those men who do evil, those mutilators of the flesh. For it is we who are the circumcision, we who worship by the Spirit of God, who glory in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh, though I myself have reasons for such confidence. If anyone else thinks he has reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal persecuting the church, as for legalistic righteousness, faultless. But whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ, and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. Now that I have already obtained all this, or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. This is the word of God for the people of God. Yes. Please be seated. This time we'll sing, Can It Be That I Should Gain, hymn number 363, verses 1 to 5. This is one other Charles Wesley's hymn. So if you know this song, please guide, please sing loudly. Thank you. Now we are in the middle of autumn. We see that the trees around our houses, streets, and in forests are changing into more colorful leaves day by day. It is great for us to see this beautiful scenery along with the matured grains in the fields. Indeed, autumn must be the queen of seasons. I hope that you enjoy this beautiful season, walking outside and breathing in fresh air. As you may know, autumn is called by many names, such as the season of abundance, the season of maturity, the season of harvest, the season of gratitude or thanksgiving, the season of prayer, the season of reflection. As we are in the middle of autumn, I hope that we can have a great moment to look over how we have lived until here in retrospect and gratitude. Today's passage makes us think over who we are and how to live as followers or imitators of Jesus Christ. Today's passage consists of Paul's own reflections and convictions on his life journey. Yet this sharing is continued to exhortations toward the believers in Philippi. Of course, this passage is also the message for all Christians, including you and me. Today's passage begins with Paul's exhortation to rejoice in the Lord. Joy is a focal theme throughout this whole letter. Maybe 9 times or 10 times, the joy is mentioned in this letter. Even though Paul was imprisoned while he was writing this letter to the believers in Philippi, he always prayed with joy because of their partnership in the gospel from the first day with a joy. Paul rejoiced that Christ is preached in every way. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice. Paul also rejoiced as he heard that the believers' faith and service in Philippi grow through the gospel of Christ. Indeed, Jesus was the source of joy. So Paul repeatedly exhorts them to rejoice in the Lord. My brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. 31. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. As sunflower grows toward and through sun, let us grow toward and through Christ. So in the picture, do you see sunflower? It's beautiful, right? The sunflower grows toward and through the sun. In the same way, we grow toward and through our Jesus Christ. Today's passage must have been written with Paul's big concerns for the faith community in Philippi, in other words, Philippian church, which consists of Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians. Many Jewish Christians and some Gentile Christians who became Jewish proselytes claimed to practice Jewish laws and heritage. Even though they became Christians, they thought we have to practice the Jewish laws and heritages. Yet, Paul strongly believed that only Christ, the gospel of Christ, and the faith in Christ should be the core of a Christian journey. So in today's passage, we see how Paul eagerly protects the church in Philippi from those who are confident in the law, circumcision, and flesh. So Paul exhorts, watch out for those dogs, those men who do evil, those mutilators of the flesh. For it is we who are the circumcision, we who worship by the Spirit of God, who glory in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh. In this exhortation, we recognize who we are. The Bible lets us know that true circumcision is not a literal one, but the circumcision of heart. In Jeremiah, in Romans, the Bible lets us know that true circumcision is not outside or a literal thing. The circumcision of heart, internal thing. For Paul, it is faith, not circumcision, that is essential. We are those who worship by the Spirit of God. We are all worshipers. We are all priests. In Roma, in John chapter 4, Jesus said, God is Spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth. So we are now identified further as those who boast or glory in Christ Jesus. No matter who they are, Jews or Gentiles, I know that boasting or pride is a precious part of our life. So in our life journey, sometimes we say, I am proud of you. We are proud of you. So proud boasting is a precious part of our journey. In today's passage, we see that by contrast, others could have confidence on the flesh. While believers may justify boasting of what God has done for them, so they have confidence in Christ. Reading today's passage, we can recognize that Paul could be proud of himself. He also knew the fact. In human terms, Paul had every reason to be confident, more so than others. He was a Hebrew of Hebrews. In regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for legalistic righteousness, faultless. Indeed, he could be confident and proud of himself by his birth and achievements. However, after he encountered the risen Christ on the road to Damascus to persecute and arrest believers of Jesus, the conversion story of Paul, the grand reversal happened to his life journey. Before he met Christ Jesus, he was persecuting the church. However, after he encountered Christ, he became a faithful believer of Jesus and passionate missionary for the gospel of Jesus. Before Christ, he could be confident to himself in many ways. But after Christ, Anno Domini, in the year of the Lord, he was totally transformed as a man of Christ. In today's passage, Paul lets us know what change had happened to him. through the image of a prophet and Lord's account. Sometimes I think that I cannot gain new things without giving up old things. If I want new shoes, maybe I have to give up old shoes. The clothing, even mindset is same thing. If I want to have a new mindset, I have to give up the old mindset. Jesus taught his disciples, new wine must be poured into new wine skins. Paul declared in verse 7, but whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. I bet that Paul must be a courageous person with faith in Christ. In people's eyes, how splendid and brilliant what Paul has is. His faith heritage as a Hebrew of Hebrews, his Roman citizenship by birth, his academic accomplishment, and his enthusiasm by religious belief. However, he considers loss whatever was to his profit, confidence, pride, accomplishments, for the sake of Christ. In the following verse, Paul lets us know why he took this way. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowledge, Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I've lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ. Here we can see why Paul considered everything which was confident and proud of as a loss. Due to the surpassing greatness of knowledge, Christ Jesus, and that he may gain Christ. Paul's conviction, let each of us look over whether we really perceive the surpassing greatness of Christ beyond all, and whether we are so striving that we may gain Christ Jesus in our daily life. The Paul said, that I may win Christ. So when we look over our journey, when we live our daily journey, this passage makes us think of that we are really trying to win Christ, to obtain a Christ. I think that if we have time to look over our journey, especially in view of what he lost and what he learned, it will be great for us. Believing in and following Jesus, what have we gained in him? In other view, what are we laying down to gain Jesus and to be found in him? This passage reminds me of a small episode about a monkey which holds something in a bottle. The monkey could not take his hand out of the bottle until he gives up something in the bottle. Can you imagine the picture? The in the bottle, he holds something. He could not take his hand until he let go. It may imply that denouncing or laying down is a way which is needy and precious, that we may gain Christ. I would call this one the blessing of denouncing or laying down. In our life journey, when we denounce, when we lay down, will be blessed. So I call this one the blessing of denouncing or emptiness. As Paul encountered Christ, he surely recognized that a righteousness of his own that comes from law is nothing in comparison with the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. Surely the gain of being in Christ far outweighs the value of everything. Paul once possessed, thus he has willingly abandoned things that he no longer values. I would call this one blessing of surrender. This one is the blessing of surrender. Now the things that Paul prizes are knowing Christ Jesus, being found in him, and having the righteousness that comes from God. Paul eagerly wanted to know Jesus more. It is not simply to have knowledge of facts about Christ, but to enter into a personal relationship with him. Here, however, Paul speaks about knowing Christ Jesus as his Lord. The Christ whom Paul desires to know is the Christ who emptied himself and was obedient to death. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Paul wanted to know Jesus as his Lord. In verses 10 to 11, Paul again lets us know what his aim is. His aim is to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. Notice that those who are in Christ share his faith, his righteousness, and his resurrection. Also share in his sufferings. Being in Christ means following his example. Being conformed to Christ's death is an ongoing process in the life of the believer. Paul said, "We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body." Indeed, the cross and resurrection are dispensable pairs, not separable. Dispensable pairs to Jesus, also to us. The cross and resurrection all the time go together. Even though Paul believed in resurrection of Christ and believers' resurrection in him, he knows that he has not yet been made perfect or reached the goal, which will be reached only at the resurrection in the future. So he declared, Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. This is called already but not yet journey. Our journey is already but not yet journey. This is our faith journey. Christ our Lord completed his mission on earth. Yet, we do not arrive at the destination until our resurrection. In other words, here on earth, we live as heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Yet, we are called to live our life as faithful followers imitators of Christ, sharing in his glory and suffering. Here Paul uses an athletic imagery. He presses forward to grasp what he has not yet obtained, has not reached his goal. Thus, the only thing Paul does is to aim for the prize. And like an athlete running a race, he ignores what is behind him and concentrates on the goal ahead, right? When you run on the ground, if you look back, maybe you cannot run away, right? Just you run toward the finish line, toward the goal. Paul declares, brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Paul's image of the Christian life as a race reminds us that we can never rest on our laurels, prizes, because our journey is ongoing process. Maybe you might have many kinds of trophies or some plagues in your home, but we cannot be sufficient because our life is a lifelong ongoing journey. Reflecting that our life is a lifelong journey, I am reminded of a maxim, Ubo Chonni. Actually, this maxim was made by Japanese scholar. U means cow, bo means walk, chon is 1,000, li is mile, which means that even the walk of cow goes 1,000 miles. You know how cow walks, right? Very slowly, but steadily. So a Japanese scholar made this one, Ubo Chonni. Even the walk of cow goes 1,000 miles. Let us continue to learn our journeys, even slowly, yet steadily following Jesus. I think that is our journey, following Christ. Indeed, Christian life can be described as a race, marathon, not a short sprint. But this particular race is not a competition in which only one person can succeed. Maybe usually in Olympic, only three people will be prized, the gold medal, silver medal, and bronze medal. But our journey is different. It is possible for everyone who takes part to win and for everyone to receive a prize. Therefore, holding fast Jesus Christ, our Lord, let us press on toward the prize that God prepares for us. So Paul said, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. This is our journey, right? So we are called to press on heavenward. Dear friends, in today's passage, Paul exhorts us to live our journey that we may gain Christ. When he finished our journey, if we did not gain Christ, maybe we may be regrettable. So in our life journey, our goal is to gain Christ. As we know, Paul could be confident to and proud of his birth, piety, achievements. Yet, he considered everything which is confident or proud as rubbish, that he may gain Christ, that he be found in him. In the same way, let us live a journey to gain Jesus, to found in him, and have the righteousness that comes from God through faith in Jesus or faithfulness of Christ. Let us press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called us heavenward in Christ Jesus. I pray that God may guide us all in this blessed journey with assurance and faithfulness. All God's people say, Amen. Thank for your offering to God. This time we offer our offerings to God, singing Doxology 95. Let us pray together, prayer of thanksgiving. Faithful God, we bring these gifts before you to celebrate how you have made with us, your chosen people, a new and everlasting covenant through the death and rising of your Son. Do not allow us to become proud of being the people you love, but help us to be worthy of your trust and to give you a response of deep faith expressed in service. Grant this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So we'll have a closing hymn, 701, When We All Get to Heaven. just as Christ laid down his privileges for our sake, let us live the life to lay down our old privileges so that we may gain Christ, be found in him, and obtain the righteousness which comes from God. As you press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called you heavenward in Christ Jesus, may God bestow divine grace, strength, peace, and love upon you day by day, newly and abundantly. Amen.